At AIA Australia, helping your clients in their time of need is our number one priority. In 2016, we paid over $1.15 billion in claims to both retail and group members. That's over $4.5 million every working day. To offer your clients cover you can trust, chat to your AIA CDM today.
Welcome to XWide Live. Today we've got financial wellness and advice. And today's special guest is Gavin Glozier from Your Wealth Hub. We've had a bit of a super sub for Mark Bynum for certain reasons. But Gavin is across all this stuff. He's got some great things to share with us and hopefully inspire some advisors out there to make changes and adopt new things in their business. Gavin's heavily involved with AFA with the Leaders Forum. So if you've you might have seen him around organising separate conferences and things like that. He does a great job there, and he's a very keen surfer. So spends a bit of time on the north side. Loves getting away for a good surf, and when he's not in the office. So Gavin, welcome.
Thank you.
How about you share a bit of your background? And you're welcome.
Yeah, absolutely, mate. Firstly, thanks for having me on today. Yeah, Mark had to unfortunately sub out today, and he thought, all the same, probably best get me involved. We've kind of been working on Your Wealth Hub now for 2 years, and it's grown to a great little program, which I'll share a little bit more about today. But yeah, my background, I joined Mark's business about 3 years ago, coming up in September, so almost at my anniversary there, which is exciting. And before that, I was in the corporate world, so I was holding different positions with Macquarie Bank, Macquarie Life there, in Asteron and AMP, which was my last role as state manager there. And got talking to Mark about what he wanted to do in his business, and he said, why don't you come over and help me position what we're doing for the future. So a big part of the role was all about kind of reshaping an existing large practice and position it so it can be reactive and more importantly, proactively managing and becoming more agile for our clients of the future. And that was the challenge that was set. And, you know, it's kind of weird looking at 3 years on how much we've achieved, but we're sitting in a really good position now. And I'll talk a bit about more about that journey today.
Yeah, so in a bit of a summary, like what is Your Wealth Hub, and how would you describe it?
Yeah, Your Wealth Hub is a financial wellness program that we roll out to corporates, and we initially built Your Wealth Hub as a solution that we saw an issue, I suppose, that was facing the corporate super community. And in Australia, there's probably about 30 or 40 actual corporate super specialist firms. And at the time, 3 years ago, grappling with what my super was actually going to do. And, you know, Mark, by his own admission, had said, you know, we worked with a lot of our corporates in the past, but, you know, we feel we could be doing so much more. So we kind of put our heads together and worked on what it is that we need to do to, A, be successful in our business, but, B, you know, really kind of challenge the status quo around how you engage and how you kind of take advice out to the people. And you know, if you look at the statistics, they really haven't changed. When 2 out of 10 people put their hand up to engage, and 8 out of 10 really kind of continue on doing their own thing and kind of not really engage at all. So we figured that had to change. And first and foremost, that had to change. So we created this concept of Your Wealth Hub, where we would go out to employer groups and really advocate financial wellness. Financial wellness two and 3 years ago was not really a concept that was really kind of used a lot in Australia. In the States, financial wellness and kind of wellness programs are quite prevalent. I saw a stat the other day which highlighted that 86% of businesses in the States have some kind of financial wellness program, where over here in Australia, there's only 9%. So, you know, we've got a long way to go if we kind of compare ourselves to what's happening in the States. So we decided to build a holistic program that would take out, a very clear and kind of concise program for employers to show them how financial stress impacts their workplace, but then empowered their staff to take control of their financial affairs. And as opposed to having people, you know, 80% of people not really taking any note of their financial affairs or not knowing where to turn, we decided this program and building this program, we take that into account and build, you know, ongoing monthly education updates and face-to-face education sessions in the workplace and lunch, brown bag lunch sessions, those types of things and things like that. And then we have our website and our financial knowledge center, which Energy helped power for us, which is fantastic. All together, we've got this program, which is pretty cool.
So I guess it's a bit reactionary, but also you guys haven't just reacted to the changes with FOFA and things like that. You've also sort of said, oh, how can we take this a step further and make a real good go of it? What are some of the, to give people an understanding of, because you've done a bit of research around all the needs and how this, the problems that employees are dealing with. What are some of the stats that you've discovered over the last few years?
Yeah. Probably one of the best reports that may even have been a bit of the backbone for this came out of the Wesley Mission Financial Stress Report that came out in May 2015. And it showed that kind of 40% of people suffer financial stress. And as a result, they move into this kind of realm of presenteeism. And presenteeism is, the impact of being physically present but mentally absent. So in that, we were finding people were doing things they shouldn't be doing in the workplace. And typically they spend, on average, an hour a day doing things they shouldn't be doing, which means if people are financially stressed, they're doing things other than their work, which is impacting the bottom line of productivity in a workplace. So for us, when we went out and talked about the impact of financial stress with employers, we were able to share that financial stress is real. We can show you how financial stress and the lack of productivity from some of these people is impacting you. And that was a big eye-opener for a lot of people. If you consider 1 hour a day from 40% of your staff, and take an average salary times that by your number of employees, it's a pretty crazy number. And for most people, I think if you look at a business with 1,000 employees, you're looking at about $3.5 million worth of lack of productivity straight off the bat. So it's pretty crazy. And when you start talking to HR directors, they love the concept of empowering their staff members and getting them over the whole burden of financial stress. But then you often speak to the CFOs who are paying for the program, and you start sharing statistics about lack of productivity and where you could be, and that's where they get really excited. And that's the cool part. That's the cool part.
So how do you, obviously there's a big need. What are the steps you guys take to go about this? And obviously engagement's a big part of how you're going to make an impact if no one's actually paying any attention. So what are some of the things you do to engage the employer base?
Yeah, absolutely. So first and foremost, we went to all our corporate super partners. We had a pretty good response from the vast majority saying, you know what, we really like what you're trying to do here. We share with them the story about the evolution of financial advice and obviously empowering people that wouldn't typically get advice. And success for us was always going to be if we could touch more Australians and allow more people to get educated in the basics of financial awareness, then they're going to be better off. So first and foremost, we went back to our corporate partners. In doing that, the vast majority were really, really receptive, and we've been able to roll out induction programs, and then we roll out 3 education sessions per location per year. Outside of corporate super, we found that there was a market of people who wanted to actually be in this space but didn't know how to. And we typically found that businesses between 100 staff and kind of 500 staff, with maybe a sweet spot between 3 and 500, was kind of where we found that it worked really well. They're big enough where they knew they had to do something, but not big enough where they had a team of people that could actually build something themselves. So in that, we take pretty much the same message, talking about financial empowerment and financial wellness and getting people to think in the right sphere, and took it out to these employees directly. So this is away from kind of the corporate super conversation. Same thing, if you look at statistically that 9% of Australian businesses have some kind of financial wellness, our stats kind of reflected that initially. Then we started refining our messages and moving away from where at first we went out talking about financial literacy and talked about financial wellness and holistic kind of financial affairs and kind of how we can support that, sharing tools and the education sessions, etc. We got a much better response, which is great.
So what were some of the hiccups that you sort of came across with, and learnings that you had on the way there, things that didn't work and things that sort of worked well?
Yeah, absolutely. I think probably the biggest learning was taking our industry speak and taking that out to consumers and employers. I think we in the financial planning profession, we understand exactly what we're about and how we do what we do. I think we took the concept of financial literacy out first, expecting that people would gravitate towards it. But we found quite the opposite. We found that people saw that as a negative. The reason I felt strongly that we needed to change it is people felt that they thought they didn't know what they were talking about. So the illiteracy part was a real turn off for a lot of people. When we moved and shifted to financial wellness, people kind of got it, and it was much more of a subtle kind of conversation. And you know, combination of that, and then we had a couple of good clients come on board, share their experiences, and kind of using some of the new reports that's been coming out of the States and Canada. It was a matter of, you know, if you consider like a watch, a timepiece, you know, lots of moving parts. And if you move everything the right way, you're eventually going to get a combination that works really well. So it was refining that message that I think's got us into, you know, more businesses that want to, you know, do more with their staff.
Mm. Well, there's a lot of advisors out there that might have a couple of corporate books on as part of their practice. Is this the sort of stuff that some advisors could do themselves out to these corporate books to re-engage and to get an uplift engagement?
Yeah, absolutely. It was funny. Kind of when we went to market and started talking to people about what it is that we were doing, I think we went to the AFA conference 2 years ago, and we had a stand there, and we thought we'll just try it. We took a box and you know, very small box in the corner. We had a stream of people kind of come by and have a look, and you know, slowly but surely, a few advisors who had dormant you know, corporate super books, but hadn't been aware of what the changes for my super actually meant, started saying, "Okay, so how would this work?" And we sat down and firstly explained the my super experience, and then we started talking about, well, this is how it would impact your client book, but more importantly, rather than just dealing with the people that are in the fund, in the default fund, you get to deal with 100% of the member base inside that corporate. And that instantly turned, you know, a few people, you know, to be pretty excited about what it actually meant. So now we find ourselves where we have advisors who use us in their tender process. So they use us as an outsource resource, and we come in with the education component, and obviously we'll deliver the financial wellness program. And that's, you know, like I said, it's a conversation between the advisor and us, and we've got different incarnations of that. But you know, for the majority of the time, you know, we deliver the majority of education. We run the monthly educational updates that come through one-on-ones. The advisor may want to be involved in the one-on-ones, and they can jump in and do those one-on-ones. Typically, we find that most advisors just want a particular type of business. The way we've set up Your Wealth Hub is that we can do everything from kind of self-directed. You can jump online and do a, you know, tax return for $20 through an online portal, or you can do a free debt review, or you know, get an online will. They're things that people will probably do themselves anyway. And the next level is, if you want to put your hand up for advice, you may want to use the financial health check tool, which we use. And in that, that's a great lead generator for people to then call back that member and talk about what the next steps are. And that's what we see a lot of people use. And that's a real benefit, because, you know, as I said, you know, it is a lead opportunity off the back of that, having the right questions and asking the right questions to help that.
Yeah, so I guess what you mentioned is a key differentiator in terms of when you're looking at corporate super traditionally, it's required clients to really opt into that, because there's a super choice out there. And if clients haven't opted into that corporate super fund, then that practice doesn't have as much engagement with that employee, essentially. So what you guys are looking at is, you've got, across the whole business, and the employer makes a call that everyone gets exposure to this. Yeah. And you've got a whole lot of other channels that you wouldn't have with just ordinary corporate super, I guess. Is that?
Yeah, absolutely. Look, the strong feedback we got initially was that our members, our employees, they don't want to talk about super. They don't care about super. You know, as sad as that is, you know, we all know the stats of how important it is, but we think it's great. It's just not even in their sphere. So for us, you know, we go out talking about financial goal setting for the year, and we talk about good debt versus bad debt. Might be talking about renting versus buying. What are the statistics around that? We talk about what's in it for them in the budget. We talk at the end of tax year around how to prepare yourself for a better tax return, how to buy your first property, you know, different ways of saving. Acorns have come on the journey with us and they've partnered with us. You know, we talk about micro investing and how that works. Now, anything that people want to engage in, they get to do it at their own pace. But the thing that they expect us to talk about is the stuff that, you know, they don't really want to know about. So by talking about, you know, the debt piece, the cash flow piece, and, you know, using some of the tools that we have to get people excited, you inevitably get to talk about those great you know, things that we can do. We talk about a whole range of other things as well, which is by far the most important part. And equally, one of the things that we learned about refining our message, it wasn't just talking about super, because we all know how that goes.
Yeah, exactly. Well, I guess one of the things that a lot of people will be curious about is you've talked about a few things that you plugged into it. What's the tech behind all this? What sort of, how does it all work together? What are some of the cool tools that you use that maybe other people can make use of that you might suggest?
Yeah, absolutely. So energy forms a big part of our backbone. You know, we use energy for our knowledge center. You know, I'm a big believer in what Rob and the guys have done there.
That's the one that's X-Plan owned now, or Iris owned?
Iris owned now. You know, I think they do a great job. And, you know, if you look to see who's out in the marketplace, there's very few people who come close with the level of detail that they go to. And they're really user-friendly. They're really light. I really like them. I'm a big fan. We use My Prosperity as well. So in terms of like the cash flow conversation for a lot of our younger members that are part of it, you know, they want the basics. They want to have control and visibility of everything. So My Prosperity's worked really well. So we'll do kind of like little coaching sessions on how to get the most out of the My Prosperity software, which is great. Acorns I mentioned as well. You know, I think Acorns is a great piece of technology that's been able to come to Australia. I saw an article yesterday that they just topped out at $100 million of funds, which is fantastic. So, you know, they're doing really well. And no doubt the guys are going to do a lot of work there to continue to invest in that software. We use the Astute Wheel for different aspects, the financial health check we use in there. We have basically in the self-service area, we have different kind of forms. I think we use some JOT forms in there as well. Which I think, Adrian, you may even put me onto a little while ago.
No mind a job form.
Exactly right. We also, we've got
Have you started, I know I showed you Zapier once. Did you end up getting any zaps going yet?
I got very excited about Zapier and got back to the office and started looking. Oh, I can do this and this, but I haven't implemented any yet. But that's definitely on the list. Absolutely, I know you.
I hope so. And what else in terms of marketing and that sort of thing? How do you?
Yeah. So from a marketing perspective, we have kind of these monthly kind of educational updates that we kind of refine as well. We add a few different stories in. So that's a big part of what we do. We use Time Trade to book one-on-one meetings with people who come to our education sessions. So after every education session, we have a one-on-one kind of afternoon kind of booked out. So we use Time Trade to kind of book through that. We use Rocket Seed for our communications and marketing in that respect.
So tell me a bit more about Rocket Seed. How's that work?
Yes. So kind of personalized emails and also email tracking and for us, you know, we can send all our electronic communications out and obviously get all the success rates and bounce backs and everything. So
it's probably a bit like Active Campaign or something like along the
very similar. One thing we just kind of picked up is Pipedrive. That's another one that we use to manage kind of leads that come off the back of it, which is pretty cool. I'm a visual person. I like to see things. So Pipedrive was a really cool way of kind of understanding where people are at in our process. Mm-hmm. We've got a couple of others that are coming on very soon. We've got a partnership with Spriggy that's coming on, a partnership mm-hmm. with Direct Money. We've got a partnership with Discover 365 that's a new one. Mm-hmm. And that's basically our member benefits portal. So I didn't talk about that before, but that's kind of part of, you know, the carrot or the stick type of thing. You know, for us, we want to be able to encourage people to come to our site and experience our education sessions and engage online. So mm-hmm. they're able to allow to help people kind of come on board and see some great specials with travel and accommodation. So that's really important for us as well to be able to reward and obviously educate at the same time.
Mm. Well, I guess when you're talking about the technology with the talking about Pipedrive and how that flows through and the visualization of it, I guess a lot of people, like when you look at full service advice, there's a whole suite of like, I guess, other things that come into play. How do you, what are the key transition points for clients as they escalate to something that's more holistic advice? Are there two or three points where you acknowledge that, oh, these are significant, they've just transferred into another, a more engaged setting?
Yeah, absolutely. So we have kind of three levels of engagement. We've got quite clearly the self-directed, and they're people that may come to an education session, they may pick up some information, and they may just jump back on the website through the login, and they can cruise around themselves. And our first point of call through the Financial Wellness Program is to encourage as many people to jump back into the website and explore, look at a video, look at an article or a learning module, whatever it may be. So that's kind of first and foremost, that's our kind of default position. Secondly, we go to the next level where people may want to, maybe come out armed and dangerous, they've got a bit of information, and they may want to go and execute one of the low-cost solutions that sit on there at the moment. So if they want a tax return or insurance review or consolidate your super, get a will, debt, whatever it may be, there's oodles of different options there. It's a self-directed space. When people come back at that point and say, look, you know what? I know what I need to do. I just don't quite know how to do it. Then we move into a scaled advice conversation. And that's when they'll move to either a null and co or a strictly super conversation, and they can have a conversation around that. And that's where, I suppose, for other advisors who have looked at this have found it attractive, because that's where the lead generating opportunities come in for those advisors. So if someone puts a hand up for advice, we send that lead straight back to the advisor that's giving, that obviously owns that fund or has the association. So that's the kind of the second and third step. And, you know, obviously the pipe dream for us is then move into a full advice conversation, and then people can engage. So we've seen situations where people will come back to us after a period of time and say, hey, I saw your education session. I really liked what you're saying there about maybe retirement. And we've had a few of those in recent times. I need to get my pension sorted out now. How can we sort that out? And then more often than not, they'll say, yeah, no worries, speak to my wife as well. And then we start kind of having the engaged conversation. So that kind of 6 month, 9 month, 1 year is typically when we see people starting to come back and ask questions. If they've done two or three sessions, we know that probably they're going to do something with us. And then we look at the stats as well around the analytics of who's looking at which articles. If we see people who are looking at the same type of article, we know that they're going to be a high chance of kind of having a conversation soon. So we preempt that call and drop them a line or help them out with some more information. So,
So with, like, if we're looking at practices that don't have as much resources out there and they've maybe got a bit of a dormant client base that they want to re-engage, what are the areas that you're seeing that you get the most engagement out? So if they can only pick, they've got so much time, they've got to pick something and they've got to try and reactivate and get a bit more engagement. What would you suggest that they look at? What have you seen the most success with?
Yeah, I think debt plays a big part in people's lives. And when you consider from an emotional attachment, the biggest component in your paycheck that goes and leaves your account every week is debt. And when you start talking to people about good debt versus bad debt, or perhaps being in a position where they, don't feel comfortable with their current provider, I think having a conversation, alerting them to what's happening in the marketplace, or, is your debt structured the right way? Are you getting the most out of whatever it is that you may be invested in or whatever? That tends to have a really good reaction for us. Mm-hmm. Probably a close second. And strangely enough, although people don't kind of get involved too much in super, we talk to a lot of people who don't have beneficiaries or their beneficiaries expired through binding nomination. That gets us really good feedback at the same time. So we get a lot of people interested to know how do we get it up to scratch. So I think definitely kind of the debt conversation is one that works really well. Secondly, beneficiaries, if they do have a dormant client base that they know they've expired. And thirdly, particularly for Gen Y, we ran a session for under 25-year-olds in April. And for them, the two kind of key things that came out of that was cash flow and lifestyle in that bucket. And the second was buying versus renting and saving for the first home. Mm. So other two areas we had a lot of kind of focus on it, and we've got another session coming up. We're going to focus on the whole buying versus renting. So
well, that got us a lot of kudos. In Sydney, I guess that's, and any capital city, I guess it's.
It's all relative. It's hard. There's a lot of competition, and the people who are 25 at the moment, the people that we're talking to, they're almost kind of, I suppose, made themselves redundant to the fact that I'm not going to buy my first home. Like, it's going to be that much of a struggle. Through the tools and what we're able to do to educate people, I think we can do a whole lot to help comfort them and get them in the right sphere if that's what they want to do.
Mm. So these people are filtering through the different stages of engagement. What are the sort of percentages that that are work, like how from the initial, okay, an employer's on, how many people are making it through the different stages and actually engaging on a percentage basis?
Yeah. So if you look at, I suppose, leads from the start of the year that have been generated, that we're talking, having an active conversation about, we're probably looking at about 10%. So 10% of people have come through and have shown interest in something.
And so attended us, the workshop or?
No, of the total pool at the moment.
Okay.
So people engaged in your wealth hub. So for us,
you've gone out to a new employer and you've set up an account, and these people have set up the employees have set up an account, 10% of those people.
Yeah, we typically see 40% of those people engage, which funnily enough is around that financial stress number that we talked about at the start of the year. We know that 20% are going to have a relationship already and probably going to feel pretty confident because they're talking to you, someone else, or another advice practice. So we kind of discount them off the top, and we're left with 40% of that. So half of those people are going to be financially stressed in some way. And our numbers of engagement line pretty well up with the people that need it. So we're pretty stoked with that. Mm. So we know that of people that kind of come along to an education session or come to a one-on-one, half again will engage and then half again will proceed. So for us, that 10 to 12% figure is pretty well on par where it needs to be.
Yeah, great. And these at the end of this, you're getting a number of full service ongoing clients that are committed to a sort of obviously you need to do the education around full service advice.
Absolutely. So the vast majority is in a scaled conversation, and it might be just looking at one aspect of their financial affairs. Mm-hmm. But then through that body of work, it allows you to ask the question about what's next. And then after that first initiation, it's then where do we go from there? Typically, I'll say, look, just sort out my pension, or just consolidate my super, or I need to update my insurances. Can you just do a review, something like that? But that's obviously the past. Back to the planning practice. Mm-hmm. Your Wealth Hub doesn't give any advice. It's completely an educational service. So everything that we do with other people, it's basically we'll alert and kind of market and be able to engage so people understand and learn more. And then if they want to, they can then speak to somebody else about that stuff.
So for the guys out there that are sort of, they've got holistic advice and They may have struggled to sort of scope things down, and how do you sort of modulize things so you can have a couple of, personal advice touch points before it gets to what would be a comprehensive SOA potentially. Are there any suggestions you have around how people should go around that, about that?
Yeah, I think the jump that's made between general information and factual information moving to a scaled advice to a full advice needs to be really, really clear and needs to be documented really, really well. You walk a fine line depending on the types of questions that you ask. If someone comes to you straight away and says, this is the situation, you uncover more of a need, obviously your obligation is to go into that into greater detail. So it becomes a little bit hard to have a scaled conversation if they then talk about their debt and their credit card debt and what's happening at home and all the rest. So I don't think in any situation you will want to move down a scenario where it's just about having a scaled advice conversation. It's about asking the right questions up front to get the right answers. And for us in Nolan Co. and Strictly Super, we have our own financial services license. It sits the same as any other license, but different licensees are going to have their rules around what you need to do at different stages. So I think what everyone will say consistently, it's all back down to the questions that you ask and addressing the need presented to you.
So you're essentially still advocating, once it crosses over to an engagement with a licensed advisor, the GP approach still needs to apply where you're evaluating someone's situation and
absolutely.
No scoping prior to that when it comes to a licensed person in your business.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. If someone comes through your Wealth Hub and says, look, specifically, we need to address my TTR, or I'm 30, I want to get my first house, I need to get a home loan, whatever the case may be. Once you've gone through that professionally, obviously you understand where they're at. the questions you ask after will lead you down the journey around what it is they actually need, what's powering that conversation. And in that, you can get a great outcome by not just addressing the immediate need, but obviously doing so much more for them if that's the case. The challenge comes when someone says, you know, it's just super. Just look after my super. It's all over the place. I've got 15 accounts and there's $5,000 in each of them and that's it. You know, that's the challenge sometimes. And a lot of the time, you know, we're having conversations with people that really aren't familiar with how advice works. And having a conversation around, you know, the value we bring looks like this. And that may be something very different to, for people who are looking for a transactional relationship. They can still have a transactional relationship. It just needs to be clearly articulated that this is the scope of what we're doing.
Yeah. Okay. Well, thanks for breaking that down. I think a lot of, we had a great session with Dante DeGore the other week around and really got a bit in the thick of it around general advice and personal advice with a lot of these online solutions now and looking at what regulates them and what regulates a personal advisor and how personal advisors have to jump through so many hoops and is that same requirement going through? I guess with what you do at this stage, it is very much, it's not even in the general advice space. It's actually, it's really at that step before general advice, really a whole education piece around, like with what Energy does. I understand there's tests in there as well that they've got that, so education, there's tests in the energy piece and
quizzes and all things like that. But I suppose the key is in those specific areas, the businesses we brought together that basically created and are part of your wealth hub all work under their own general AFSLs. So the information that they provide and they share basically sits signed off from those businesses. You know, we've facilitated a great solution. We've gone a step further and been able to hold people's hands to engage and bring them together with something they probably needed some time ago. One thing I kind of learned a long time ago in corporate world was that, you know, a lot of businesses have these fantastic tools. They're amazing and they're constantly building these things. They're throwing them over the fence, telling the world how great they are. But what's lacking there is people to sit down with them and show them and hold their hand how this will benefit them. And that's where we really sit in a privileged position to be able to go out and bring these great tools to these people that wouldn't typically have picked up one of these amazing kind of, you know, a lot of money spent on these tools. We're able to join them together and show them how to benefit and show them how this is going to help make their life easier and understand their financial position. And I think that's a big part of what we do that underestimate sometimes. You know, we do facilitate so much. And, you know, there's some great tools out there. We've just gone out to market and found them, brought them together, packaged them up, and now we tell people about them. You know, the rules are the same for everybody. What we're doing is kind of, I suppose, you know, facilitating the best outcome and looking for the best tools to help people.
Yeah, well, you're doing, things are moving along pretty nicely for you guys, I think. I think you said you've got a new evolution coming in the next little while. You've got a bit of an upgrade.
Yeah, we're doing version 2.0. So we're bringing a whole new range of solutions with partners we've gone out to the marketplace for. We'll have aged care solutions. We'll have banking solutions for kids, which we talked about through Spriggy. Consolidation of credit card debt tools, salary packaging tools, and a new member benefits portal that we're kind of bringing on as well. So there's a lot of cool things in the build at the moment. So the next kind of 3 or 4 months are going to be pretty exciting for us.
Well, you've had a bit more of an established point at the moment. If you look back over the last few years, what are some of the things that you might have done differently or in retrospect?
Yeah, good question. You know what, the last 3 years have been an absolute journey. You know, we've come in and, you know, Mark and I spent a lot of time together talking about, you know, what it is we want to achieve out and the objectives of the business. And, you know, Mark's had a great business, been in the business for 28 years. You know, he wanted this to be a chance to really grow and bring in, you know, specialized partners and to do what we've done with your Wealth Hub, you know, and we've been able to use that to educate some of our Nolan Co clients at the same time. For us, what has worked well is having a plan and executing to plan. Sometimes, you know, things come up stuff doesn't always go to plan. I suppose probably one of the biggest lessons is, you know, when something's not going right, it's calling it early, because it's only going to cost you longer term. So sometimes you get really emotionally attached to some of, you know, maybe a partner that's come on board, or perhaps a strategy you're trying to play. Being able to recognize and calling it early so you don't kind of lose too much time and money over it is probably a big lesson. And it's probably been a couple of those that we probably let go a little bit too long. But, you know, we're in a good place now, and it's looking good. But I think in business in general, you know, being able to see if something's not going well, calling it early is important.
Well, I suppose if it's not really working, your job's not really around, is it? The fact that you're still employed is a good sign, isn't it?
Well, we're still going.
You wouldn't come cheap, mate.
Absolutely.
So, with what you guys have been doing in the corporate space, it's sort of, I'm really keen to sort of bring it tight as much back into the broader advice community and sort of look at what sort of concepts they can get out of it and apply to a lot of the unengaged clients that most practices have. What are maybe some of the things you do you would adjust or focus on if you were doing that approach and focusing on a group of clients that are just linked to a product?
Yep. Talk to them. First thing I would do is talk to them, find out what they're thinking. The Gen Y under 25 session we did came out of a combination of knowing that they're going to be our next generation of clients, but equally we had a large number of existing clients where their kids didn't feel engaged with their finances and their parents were taking to retirement concerns around what's going to happen to my kids. They're going to inherit all this money and not really know what to do with it, how to respect it, and they're concerned they're going to blow it. Mm. So for us, we got a whole bunch of them in and said, this is what we're thinking. This is what we want to do for you guys. And we talked about cash flow and all the great tools out there and property and whatnot. And said, yeah, that's good, but we want to understand, you know, I don't think we're even going to buy anything. You know, renting versus buying, is it even worth me even renting? Like, well, I should just stay home for longer. So we refined a whole bunch of our messages so we could, you know, better target the people that we wanted to engage with. So, you know, for people who do have clients that are perhaps dormant or haven't done much, first and foremost, find a bunch of like-minded ones together and ask them, what are you concerned about? What is it that's keeping you up at night? And where do you want to be in 3 years? What do you want to have achieved short term? But where do you want to be in 10 years? How do you want your balance sheet to look, your personal balance sheet? I tell you what, you get some pretty eclectic answers. You know, people want to travel the world. People want to kind of go out and feel financially wealthy, independently wealthy. But whatever it is, you get enough people thinking the same way. There's going to be others who feel, you know, not too dissimilar to what they're saying. So it'll work. And then it's about marketing and having something that's different, not talking in product terms or talking in industry speak. It's about taking your message to the people in a language they can understand. And the last one that we did for Noll & Co that's been really successful is having people ringing our clients a couple of times a year, just seeing how they're going, just an ad hoc, off-the-cuff chat. And, you know, in that space of time, we've been updating contact details, finding a bit more about them. And off the back of that, we end up getting a whole bunch of interest in new services that we offer as well. So for us, it's been it's pretty good. You know, we've been re-engaging and engaging and creating.
You said it just comes back to what the guys that used to, when I was in AMP Horizons, used to come in and tell us it's just about activity, guys. Is that what you're saying, Gavin?
I wouldn't say it's activity, because that's what they were suggesting. But it kind of is. You know what? It is. And, you know, every chance you get to get that message out is a marketing opportunity. And whether that's on Facebook, Twitter, through different blogs, through articles you may be writing for the industry, whatever it may be, it's all about brand awareness and credibility. And I think in some cases we can go super crazy and put lots of brand credibility pieces out there and neglect kind of what our core is. At the end of the day, our clients are at the center of everything that we do. And, you know, one of the things that I've tried to bring from corporate into small business is every decision we make has to benefit the client. If it's not going to benefit the client, then we're not going to do it. Simple as that. So, you know, there's simple rules that we should be applying in our businesses. Marketing ourselves and our brand is super important. Makes it so much easier for clients to be, I like to call it a raging advocate for what we do. And you know, really, that's someone who stops mid-conversation at the barbecue or somewhere where someone says, oh, yeah, my financial plan does this, but not this. Your client, if they're a raging advocate, will stop and say, no, no, you need to speak to Adrian. He's done this for us. He's amazing. He's always in touch. That's success in our industry. That's success for us. We have raging advocates for clients. I think, for me, that's what I tell the team here, is that that's the gauge of success. And if everything we do is centered around them, then we'll do a really good job and people will come to us all the time.
Do you have any, I guess, have you managed to keep any stats around client referrals or anything like that? Is that something that you're across?
Yeah, we haven't captured the stats as yet. It's a good question. Caught me off guard. That's great. We see the majority of lead activity that we have comes from us kind of continuing to engage our existing client base for Null & Co. and for through your wealth hub and using Strictly Super as an example in that pool. We're constantly kind of marketing to those guys and talking to them about different things. So we've got 24 touch points a year for both of those programs. So there's a lot of activity, varying activity from kind of, you know, phone calls and education sessions and newsletter educational updates. There's lots of varying different things. Mm. So, you know, you get to see what's going on. But for us, a big part of the Null & Co. increases come from just re-engaging and talking to our clients that have been probably, you know, a little bit unloved over the years, and now they're feeling more love. And I think every time that you speak to these guys, they kind of come a little bit closer. And the closer they are to our camp, the more of a chance we're going to have to ask them the critical questions that are going to lead to, you know, them saying, you know what, I need to be doing business with you. And in turn, they become a raging advocate. So it's incremental, but we're doing well.
Yeah, awesome. Well, for the people watching live, feel free to throw in any questions. We've got a few more minutes with Gavin. I'm curious about what you see. You've done a bit of looking over into the US, and you're very curious fellow, Gavin. You like to stay on the pulse. What are some of the things you see, opportunities in the industry coming forward, and what are some of the things you've got your eye on?
Yeah, I've seen a lot of talk recently about robo-advice and if it is and isn't working in Australia, and people talk traditionally about sample sizes of data not being big enough, and, you know, whatever kind of brings more attention to people getting support and help, I think is a great thing for our industry. Our profession is built off, you know, the advice that we have or the information we have and us sharing it. And I think between financial advice firms working together, trying to think of new ways that we can kind of talk to more people, I think is a really, really a good kind of initiative I think we need to be doing more of. In the States, they seem to be doing a lot of that. There's a lot of sharing. I know FinCon's coming up, and, you know, you start to look through the agenda and kind of how people are working and collaborating. You know, that's amazing. I think having more people working together is only good for advice in Australia. Using
tools, XY Advisor a bit there then, Kevin?
I may have touched on that, but yeah, that's the live. Is that the live feed that's happening from over there? Is that right?
Yeah, I will be doing a live one. Absolutely, yeah. So we might get you involved there. Oh, unless we can get some big hitters. Who's going to be there? Who are you looking forward to?
That's a good question. I've been scanning the agenda, and I'm trying to put through a hit list of who I want to see first and foremost. And there is so much good content on there as a whole. I probably don't have a top, but I think all in all, it's going to be my first FinCon. But I think, I don't know. Jeez, who's going to be the best? Everything looks amazing. The whole thing looks great. And I think it's worth jumping along.
You're going to have some good tour guides over there for you. Peter Dimitides. Daniel. Steve Crawford will probably be there. He loves that.
Yeah, Steve will be there. Yeah, I heard he's coming along. Yeah, it should be really good.
I think as well.
It should be good. I'm looking forward to see what else comes out. You know, one of the big finds, I think, in the last couple of years was Acorns and micro investing. I'm a big fan of it. I think it's a really great way to take, you know, incremental savings and put it to a good cause, but teach people at the same time. That's been working really well. Map My Plan is something that we've looked at. And we're looking and have been kind of working on implementing into our business with samples at the moment. So that's looking very strong and very positive. I think anything that kind of raises the profile of kind of people's personal finances and making it easy I think it's a really big thing. So like my prosperity, I think for us has been really good. And looking at what they're doing to introduce more benefits into and kind of tools.
Yeah, it's an exciting space. We're going to have Chris Ridd on in a few weeks as well, actually.
So. Yeah, brilliant. Yeah, very switched on guy. I think anything in that space that comes up is great. I think in advice practices, you know, I mentioned Pipedrive before. That's something that we recently got onto. We use Xplan for our kind of threads and processes and our kind of compliance back end. But, you know, the more and more we kind of, I explain probably like this, but the more and more we kind of move along, you know, what we want to do functionally for our clients and how we deliver a better service, we have to look at these different types of software that specialize in aspects of what we do. Mm. And hesitantly, we don't want to be using, you know, lots of different software, but at the end of the day, the efficiency it brings, it just speaks for itself.
You just got to do it. Mate, you've been great in sharing how you guys operate and what you guys are delivering to, I guess, what might be termed the other 80% of the population. So it's good to know they're getting something, and it's good to know that some of them are making the journey into full service financial advice along the way. It's really cool what you guys are doing, and big shout out to Mark and the team that are running it and having a crack. So. If anyone's got any other questions for Gavin, just pop him in the Facebook group there, tag him in there. He's in there. He'll be able to, answer it, put him on the spot. I can sometimes be not as hard hitting as some people might want me to be around the numbers, but yeah, throw him in there. He'll be on show, so he'll have to answer the questions. So thank you, Gavin, your Wealth Hub, and a big thank you to AIA, and, we'll see you guys next week.
All right, thanks very much.